Hi guys, my name is Mansi Anand and welcome to the new session of RBI 24/7. So, जैसे कि आप लोग को पता ही है कि इस session में we usually discuss a set of 5 questions and that can be of use to you if you are preparing for competitive exams. So, let's not waste any time and move straight away to question number 1. But before doing that, as a daily routine, I would like to ask you to subscribe to our channel. So, if this is the first video of our channel that you are watching, then do not forget to hit the subscribe button and you can also press this bell icon if you want to get notified जब भी कोई new नई video आती है. So, you can also join our Telegram group. On this group, you can post all your doubts and queries and we'll try to get back to you as soon as possible. So, ready for question number 1? Okay, this is your question number 1, which says that which of the following are part of parameters used by RBI in construction of its digital payment index. Moving ahead to the correct option for this question is option C. Option C means 1, 2 and 3. That means these are the correct options. Guys, first of all, we have to understand what is the meaning of this digital payment index. So, nowadays it has become really easy to make a payment. Yesterday, after my work, I was going to my home and I thought of having a chocolate. And for that, so that was nearly 100 rupee payment. And for that, I didn't pay. I was just too tired to get cash out of my wallet. So, I just thought I have phone in my hand and I will just Google Pay, right? So, the point is, we have become accustomed to the technology. So, specifically, at least people living in metro cities, jo bhi Delhi, Mumbai ya bade shaharon mein rehne wale jitne bhi log hai, unko to technology ki aadat ho hi gayi hai. So, for measuring that how many people are used to this technology or what is the level of penetration of technology in the country. कि country में कितने लोग technology को use कर रहे हैं या फिर कितने लोग comfortable हैं उसे use करने में. For that measurement, RBI has come up with this digital payment index, right? And obviously, if it has constructed an index, so what is an index? Basically, जब हम बहुत सारे चीजों को combine करते हैं, तो उसको एक index बोला जाता है. For example, let's say when you used to study in school, you had 5 subjects, right? It might be possible that in one subject you are securing really good marks. Let's say in maths you were securing really good marks, but in science you were not securing that much of good marks, right? But when we used to average out all these 5 parameters, let's say there are 5 subjects: maths, science, English, Hindi, and let's assume social studies, right? So when we used to average these 5 subjects, then it used to give you a combined parameter to look at, that this is your average performance, right? Similar is the construction of an index. You take different parameters, give weightage to it. Let's say if you want to understand that if you want to give more importance to maths because you are good in it, so we will give a high weightage to it, right? So giving weightage or not giving weightage depends upon the rules of construction of the index. So an index is nothing but a combination of different parameters that gives you an average performance in each of the subjects or in each of the constituent parameters, right? So that is an index. Now RBI wants to look at the penetration of digital payments in India. How many people are using their phones or are using digital means to make payments? For that, they need certain parameters. They have to look at just as for construction of an entire percentage, you take into account different subjects. RBI, it looks at different parameters. And there are 5 parameters which have been used by RBI. So these are the 5 parameters. So let's look at this in a diagram. I think that is going to be easier to comprehend. So these are the 5 parameters. First parameter is payment enablers. So payment enablers, it means the tools or devices which are allowing you to make payment. Just as I told you yesterday, I use my phone to make a payment of rupees 100. Now don't ask me which chocolate I bought. Okay. So these are different parameters, different enablers. You can make payment using these different modes, right? After that, payment infrastructure demand side. Basically, in order to get an idea that what is the demand of this payment infrastructure, that how many people they are demanding or they are needing such infrastructure for that, so that they can make a digital payment. So these are some sub parameters that can be used to measure it. So how many people are making payments through debit or credit cards or prepaid payment instruments. I hope we all know the meaning of PPIs. We have discussed it in earlier sessions. Mobile and internet banking, fast tags. I think before the penetration of UPI in country, internet banking used to be one major source of payment. But now after we have got familiar with Paytm's or Google Pay or Phone Pay, internet banking has lost market a little bit. After that, fast tag is also another means because it also allows you to make payments whenever you are traveling at far off distances, right? Okay, payment infrastructure, supply side. So this was demand side, basically to analyze how many consumers are wanting it. Now coming to supply side, how many suppliers are there providing these services? So these were service receivers or service basically service takers, and here are the service providers, right? How many bank branches are there, ATMs, POS terminals, right? So these are supply side parameters. Now payment performance, basically whether these payments which are being performed are taking time or not taking time, or are they being carried out efficiently, or there is some problem in their operation. So we are talking about performance, right? Unique users, paper clearing, how much currency is in circulation, because if digital payments rise, that obviously reduces the cash that is being circulated, right? How many people are withdrawing cash, or whether they want to use digital modes as their payments, the volume, right? And the value. Now coming to the last parameter, that is consumer centricity. Consumer centricity means, it basically means what is the awareness level of the consumer, right? Whether there have been complaints or how many frauds are there, because if there are going to be many halted transactions or many frauds, then they are definitely going to discourage the consumer, right? So I think if you are using any UPI modes of payments, you must have faced problems many times when the money just gets stuck, or if you are transferring it from one person to another, it just gets stopped in between and then takes a lot of time to get transferred, right? So these type of events, they discourage consumers from using technology, right? So what is the penetration among the consumers? That is the last point, consumer centricity. So these are different parameters, right? Here you can see constructed a composite digital index to capture extent of digitization of payments, basically retail payments across the country. RBI DPI comprises of 5 broad parameters. Here are 5 broad parameters along with their weightage. See, here you can see that RBI is giving most weightage to payment performance there. So they basically want more importance to be given to this parameter. That is why they are giving it more weightage, right? So guys, here is a question for you. So you have to tell me that for the construction of this RBI DPI, which year is being used as a base year? So you have to find it yourself and mention it in the comments. So I hope to see a lot of comments. Moving ahead. Okay. This is question number 2. I hope the screen is perfectly visible. Yes, it is. Okay. So this question says, Central Economic Intelligence Bureau, in a communication to Central Board of Indirect Taxes and Customs, has proposed a dash of 18% on cryptocurrency trading, right? So this is cryptocurrency trading, and the correct option for this question is option B. Option B means
goods and services tax. So see, this is just a news as of now, just a proposal, right? And there is no confirmation to it, but we are talking about it so that we can understand the concerns of different parties associated with this process of cryptocurrency trading. So guys, I hope you remember what is cryptocurrency. If you do not know about cryptocurrency, I am sure you must have heard about something called a Bitcoin. So if you are not aware of these terms, you can ask for the previous session's link in which we have discussed it. So you can simply understand it as a digital form of currency, right? Now, since Bitcoin is getting so popular these days, so if you are an avid newspaper reader, you must be knowing about the crazy trading, the crazy buying that has been taking place of Bitcoin from past 1 month. So it has crossed almost the mark of $34,000, although after that it fell a little bit. But this is a very high number for such an asset which does not even have strong fundamentals, right? So this frenzy buying or crazy buying which is taking place, that is leading to high valuations of Bitcoin, right? Now our governments or our regulators are thinking that if these transactions are taking place so much in volume, then we need to cash it out, we need to put a tax on it. That is why they are thinking to put an 18% GST on cryptocurrency trading. Sometimes we use cryptocurrency and Bitcoin words synonymously, but guys, do remember cryptocurrency is a broader term and it can include many cryptocurrencies like Bitcoin or Ethereum. One of them is now getting popular, so it's a new one which is getting really popular these days, that is called Tether, right? So there are many cryptocurrencies that are getting popular. So Bitcoin comes under the purview of this cryptocurrency term, which is an umbrella term, right? So some more details about it. Now, cryptocurrency exchanges, they are not very much in support of this idea, because the thing, if government is going to put tax on it, then our customers are going to go to international exchanges. See, cryptocurrency exchange is nothing special, but just like a stock exchange. So what is a stock exchange? A place where you can open an account and you can involve into trading of shares and stocks, right? Similarly, a crypto exchange allows you to deal or trade in crypto assets, right? So that is a cryptocurrency exchange. Now they are fearing that since government is going to put up a very high tax rate, that is 18% is very high, right? So this might discourage the consumers from dealing it over Indian crypto exchanges, and they might move to international exchanges where the taxation rate is considerably lesser. Right? So this is one fear, this is one side which is being told by cryptocurrency exchanges. Exchange executives have been quick to point out that they pay GST and commissions levied by them on crypto trading. Now these people working at these exchanges, they are saying that whatever we earn as fees or whatever is our income, we pay taxes on these. So why is there a need for another tax that can reduce our income or that can discourage our consumers, right? So exchange executives said regularity clarity will give legitimacy to crypto trading. So this is one plus point that they can figure out, that if government puts a tax on it, that means they are giving some legal validity to cryptocurrency, which has been a gray area for a long time. Gray area means even regulators don't know what to do with it, because there are no proper rules and regulations surrounding this particular financial asset. So if they come up with taxes, that means they are trying to give some legal validity. So some experts, they say that if you treat crypto assets like another assets like Bitcoin or gold, then the GST rate should not be much so much high, like 18%. It should be much less, right? So the proposed rate is quite high. And see, here you can see it is estimated that crypto trading is worth 40,000 crore per annum in India, which would mean about 7,200 crore tax revenue for the government, right? And as you know, government has been suffering from narrowing tax base and from falling tax revenue. So obviously they need some new areas where they can generate their revenue. Although this is just a proposal as of now, right? Moving ahead to the next question. So here is the third question for today, and this question says, what does it refer to? So two statements given to you and you have to select the word that gives you the correct meaning of it in both of the statements. Correct option for this question is option D. Option D means Depositors Education and Awareness Fund. Okay, so basically this is simply a fund. What is a fund? Whenever we need money for something in future, we put some of our money aside and we think that okay, when I'm going to collect considerable amount of this money, I'm going to use it to buy certain things, right? So in India especially, the older ladies, they have a tendency to store money, or whatever money they can save from their household expenditure, they save their money and collect it, right? In similar form, RBI also collects money. RBI also allows banks to collect this money in certain form, right? And now, which is this form we are talking about? Depositors Education and Awareness Fund. See, simply, whatever accounts a bank holds, right? A bank holds millions of accounts, millions of people have their account at a certain bank. So, let's say you are having an account at a branch of SBI in Delhi, right? So you are not having much money in this account. Let's say you are only having 5,000 rupees. And now you are moving to Ahmedabad, right? From Delhi you have moved to Ahmedabad, and if you want this money back, you have not closed your account because you just forgot about it, that I have such an account which I do not use much and it is acting as a dormant account. Now you have moved to Ahmedabad and here you have opened a new account at SBI branch which is near to your home in Ahmedabad. Right, here you put all your money and you carry out all the transactions. And let's assume you are super rich and 5,000 is just like a penny to you. 5,000 is nothing but change to you. That is why you think that I don't need this money. Let it be. I don't need to go to Delhi to recollect it, right? So either you can, this might be possible that you have forgotten about this particular account holding this much of money because the amount is not very high. And the second possibility is that you think to retrieve this money you will have to spend more money. Let's say you will have to go to this particular branch and you will have to spend on your airplane tickets. So basically, the cost of retrieving this money is actually more than the value of this money. That is why you think, let it be, I am not going to collect it, right? So there are many dormant accounts in Indian banks where no one is using that account and some amount of money is just sitting in that account and no one is there to claim it, right? So even banks do not have much information that where are the account holders of these particular accounts. These accounts are known as unclaimed deposits. Now, what to do with this money that banks have? Because what if they use this money? They say that person is not coming back, this money is mine now and I will use it. But what if after many, many years, this person suddenly thinks, let me just go to Delhi and get my money back, right? Or let's say this person has gone to Delhi after 10 years due to some work and now he wants his money back, right? So banks cannot deny it because actually the owner of that money is that particular person. Let's say Mr. Patel, right? 10 years, Mr. Patel thinks I need my money back, banks cannot deny it. Right? So this is what is an unclaimed deposit, an unclaimed account within a bank. So what banks do is, in this situation, they collect all the money in unclaimed deposit and they put it into a fund which is known as Depositors Education Awareness Fund. Right? So they are known as unclaimed if they are lying still and no one is claiming it for 10 years or more. It was allowed by Section 26A of the Banking Regulation Act, allows the banks to establish it, right? Here you can see, close to 18,000 crore of unclaimed deposits are lying in Indian banks, were lying in Indian banks for in the year 2019. So you can see the amount is quite high, 18,000 crore. It might seem like a big amount, but the point is, if you divide it by the number of accounts, right? If you want to see how much money is there in one particular unclaimed deposit account, then that money is not going to be high. That is why that is lying still, and people do not, the account holders, they are not caring about it. Upfront from 14,000 crore in 2018, this was the data by RBI. So under central bank rules, deposits are classified as unclaimed if they are not operated for 10 years or more. So although our regulators are working on KYC norms in which they collect information about the deposit holders, about the account holders, still they are not able to figure out the actual owners, or they are not able to trace out the account holders of these unclaimed deposits. Right? Here you can see that different categories of banks having different amount of unclaimed deposit, right? So it is not as if the customer forgot a large sum of money in his account. Essentially, the money is small that he or she does not care. They have probably moved to a different city or they have moved to another country, right? For a bank to make the effort to find these customers is a very expensive process, right? Let's say if continuing our example of Mr. Patel, for bank it is going to be really expensive to find out that where is Mr. Patel and why is he not operating this particular account, and the money in his account is only 5,000. That is why for banks also it is very expensive. It might be really expensive for Mr. Patel too, and for the banks as well. Right? That is why they do not make much effort in finding out or tracing the actual owners. Right? But if after many years this person wants their money back, they can get it. Moving ahead to the next question for today. Okay, this is question number 4, which says select the statements which are correct about e-invoicing. A simple question. Moving ahead to answer. Answer is option A. Option A means an e-invoice is nothing but a digital document that is exchanged between a supplier and buyer and validated by a government tax portal. See, e-invoice is nothing but a bill in its digital form, or you can say an invoice. What is an invoice? An invoice is a document that contains details of a transaction, right? So let's say if you go to Lifestyle for doing some shopping and you buy clothes worth rupees 10,000. Clothes worth rupees 10,000. Quite a high amount for clothes. So if you buy this amount, then you are going to get an invoice. Now what is this invoice? It contains the transactions. It contains the details of transactions. What clothes have you bought? What is the price of each of the unit that you have bought? Right? So it contains the details. The tax that is being put up on this transaction. The total amount that you have paid. Right? So all these transactions are mentioned on this invoice. When this invoice is converted into a digital format, into a digital document, then it is known as an e-invoice. See, conversion into a digital document is very important from the government point of view, because something that becomes digital allows government to track the amount of dealings happening or amount of trade that is taking place between different buyers and sellers. government that is being done on a government tax portal, right? So for GST, let's say we have this GST and GST network. If you have approval, or you can say you have validation of government, that means government knows about your dealing and your dealing is totally legal in nature, right? So that is an e-invoice. Okay, some news about e-invoicing. Proposed system where business to business invoices are digitally prepared in an e-invoicing format and authenticated by GSTN, right? So basically it is useful in B2B transactions, that is business to business transaction, specifically important in B2B transaction, right? B2B means that one business is buying from another business. Let's say there is a factory which makes jeans, and if they want to make jeans, obviously they need the raw denim cloth. Apart from that, they need buttons, they need zippers, right? So they need many components, and obviously they are going to buy it from another business which is providing raw material. So one business which is providing raw material dealing with another business which is making jeans. Simple enough? So that is an e-invoice. System ensures that common format is followed by businesses before reporting invoices to the GST portal. So one very important feature here is uniformity. That means all the businesses are filling out the details in a common format. There are certain things that they have to mention, and for maintaining that uniformity, these type of portals come in handy. So beginning this new year 2021, businesses with 100 crore sales will have to compulsorily validate their transactions in real time. Real time means when it is happening, you have to update it at the time of happening of transactions on the portal run by the National Informatics Center, that is GSTN portal, right? So with businesses with 100 crore sales, they will have to update the information. So these are certain details that are being filled in this e-invoice. Greater oversight of economic activities, as I told you, helps government in maintaining a database to know that what are the transactions or dealings happening in the country. And apart from that, it also helps government to identify whether they are getting taxes that they should or not. Basically, if they know that trade is happening at a fast rate, but they're not getting enough taxes, that means there is some sort of tax evasion going on, right? So these type of technologies or these type of upgradations help government in knowing the amount of tax that they should ideally get, right? Okay, moving ahead to last question for today. This question says, which of the following describes the possibility of something really, really good or something really, really bad happening, right? Correct option for this question is option E. Option E means tail risks. Tail risks. So let us take an example for understanding this particular concept of tail risks. So let's say you are a person who loves to travel, right? But the problem is you have got strict parents and you do not know whether they will allow you to go on trips or not. So your idea is that they are not going to allow you to go on an international trip, but they might allow you to go to Goa, right? So this is an average idea in your mind. Now something really, really good happening can be you ask your parents to go on an international trip and your parents agree for sending you to a trip to Bangkok, right? So this is something really, really good happening to you, right? So this is something really, really good. Now in case you ask your parents to go to a trip, let's say to Haridwar, but they are not allowing you to do so, So that is something really, really bad happening in this case. So Goa was an average for you. You know that they might allow it, right? So that is an average. And something really good happening is going to, on a trip to Bangkok. And something really bad happening is not even getting a permission to go to Haridwar, right? So this is basically, these possibilities, these extreme possibilities are known as tail events. See, this word tails comes from the statistical applications. For understanding this, we will have to delve deeper into statistics. That is not needed now. Why is this called tail? Simply because they are extreme events, right? At the ending of the curve, that is why they are known as tail events. So it might be possible that you are expecting this to be average, and this is something really good happening, and this is something really bad happening. Now, if we apply this concept to investing, right? So you have made an investment into a certain assets, into certain assets, let's say cryptocurrency, and you expect average return to be 20%. Now something really good can be a 35% return, and something really bad can be a loss of 5%, right? So these are really extreme events which have a very less probability. So what do you think? Are your parents going to allow you to go to Bangkok really easily? This is an event that is going to have really less probability, right? So that is why they are known as tail risks or tail events, which have very less probability of happening. But if they happen, then they can have a huge impact, right? So this can happen on both the sides, something really good or something really bad. But usually if you read the articles, if you see this term in newspaper, that is tail risk, that is in context to this part. Something really bad happening this side of the tail, not that side, right? Theoretically, it can be both sides. So why are we talking about tail risks? Because see, after witnessing or after going through a pandemic for 1 year, for more than a year now, we have realized this fact, the regulators and the policy makers have realized this fact, that we need to be prepared for such tail risks. So this outbreak of COVID-19 can also be considered as a tail risk, or the possibility of outbreak of another pandemic can be put into the category of tail risk. Because there is less probability of happening, really less, really rare event, but if it happens, it can have a devastating impact. So all the crisis, let's talk about the global financial crisis of 2008. So that was also a tail event. Really less probability of happening because there were, see, why am I saying less probability? Because there are so many layers of regulation and so many bad things were going on in that crisis, before that crisis. And the point is, no one took care or no one took any steps towards it. So that was highly unlikely. That is why we say no one taking these steps or no one mitigating this possibility of a future bad event makes the possibility really less, right? So that is tail risks. Event, something really bad happening which has a very less probability, but probably the possibility of a devastating impact, right? So these are tail risks. So you can find this term in newspapers, especially if you read editorials of economists or the policy makers. This term can easily be found. This was also popularized by a book called Black Swan Event, right? We have discussed about Black Swan events in one of our previous sessions. And also there was one paper by Dr. Raghuram Rajan in which he predicted the possibility of happening of this global financial crisis. I've told you the name of that paper many times. In that paper also, he talked about these tail risks. I think we have discussed most of this thing. Have a small probability of occur at both ends of a normal distribution curve. So this is a statistical term that we do not need to delve deeper into. Chance of loss occurring due to a rare event predicted by a probability distribution. Technically refers to both, but most concerned with losses, something really bad, not even getting permission to Haridwar. Distributions that are characterized by fat tails are often seen when looking at hedge funds return.
So this is an example of the something good happening. See, hedge funds are certain investment vehicles that allow you to invest, that allow you to earn a really handsome return on your investment, right?
So that is why they are saying that the good part or the fat tails, that means tails with really huge impact in good sense, can be understood in the return of a hedge fund.
This is an example of something really good.
Although tail events negatively impact portfolios are rare, but they have large, they may have the impact of providing really large returns. So investors should hedge against these events, right?
So can be for, is it, is this concept is valid for investors as well as companies. Companies should also prepare for such tail risks, such tail events happenings, right? So guys, these were the 5 questions for today. I hope you learned something new from this video. If you did, then do not forget to hit the like button, because I'll be back in next session with some new information. Till then, you guys take care of yourself, apni padhai karte rahe, and thank you for being here.